nella ciencia. What's up, boys and girls? We are back at our friendly place, The Hideaway, for another session.
Yes. Only got about 3 more days left in Dallas together before we hit Miami for New Year's. So yes, you guys will see some change of scenery in a few weeks. So yes. Get excited for that.
Hideaway is our nice home court, but it's always good to switch it up, and we are going to be hitting some great places in Miami, and you guys are going to love it. But while we're here, let's see if we can run it up and bring home some money.
Yeah, what casino are we going to in Miami?
We're going to the Hard Rock.
Hard Rock, make sure
to
catch
Rock
us there.
Seminole.
That guitar. Hard Rock, that
Hollywood,
guitar.
Florida.
Beautiful casino. We'll be there running it up, going into clubs out. Going back to our rooms after.
Going back to our rooms and studying for next semester.
Next semester.
You know,
now we'll keep you guys updated. Early. It's going to be a blast. We're excited. Just make sure to subscribe, catch it all.
Let's try to pay for the trip right
now. Thank you.
First hand for me, we look down at Ace Jack of Diamonds in the big blind. There are 4 limpers, and we raise it up to $20, and only 1 limper calls. So we are going heads up, out of position to a flop. Flop comes 9-7-2, 1 diamond. So we got 2 overcards, backdoor straight draw, backdoor flush draw. We make the c-bet for $20, and he rips it all in for $59. Maybe we need to be paying more attention to how many chips people have when we go into pots with them, because this is kind of gross, because we kind of just have to make the call here with ace high. Maybe we can fold, but we're just getting great odds and we can improve a lot of the times, and we might even be ahead right now if he's just semi-bluffing. So we make the call with ace high. The turn is a queen, the river's a king. We still have ace high, not expecting to be good a whole lot. He shows king jack of clubs. So we were actually in great shape the whole way. He really just needed to hit that 3-outer, and he waited till the river to do it. We are not off to a great start this session. Hopefully we can rebound.
For this hand, we look down at King 10 offsuit. I'm in middle position, and I decide to open it up to $7. We see a call from the cutoff, call from the button, and of course the big blind decides to come along for the show as well. No one really likes to fold in Texas. So we're off to a flop 4 ways, and it comes 8-9 queen rainbow. Big blind checks, I quickly check, and it actually checks around, so we get to see a free turn card, which is the 7 of clubs. Gives us the open-ended straight draw, and the big blind decides to lead out here for $20. Pretty big sizing, however, I decide to stay sticky here with the 1 over card as well as the open-ended straight draw. I make the call and the other 2 players fold, so we're off to a river heads up, and it is a nice one, the Jack of Diamonds, giving us the absolute nutter butters. We pick up the 7 cards straight, and the big blind again leads into us for $20. A really small sizing, this often indicates to me that he has a hand such as like 2 pair or maybe even a set trying to get thin value from me. Against this specific opponent, he's a pretty sticky player, and I decide to raise it a bit larger than normal. I decide to size up here to $100 as my raise. If he happened to have a 10 as well, I want to charge the max value and also bet an amount that might be callable by either a 2 pair or a set. I raise to $100 and he snap calls me, and we flip over the goods and take down a nice little pot our way.
Next hand for me, we look down at ace 7 of spades on the button. There is 1 limp, and we are going to take advantage of our position and raise it up to $15. The small blind makes the call, and the limper calls as well. So we're going 3 ways to a flop in position, which comes ace high. Comes ace 6-3 rainbow with a spade. We have the backdoor flush draw as well. Interestingly enough, though, the small blind donk bets into us for $25. The limper folds, and I really just think a call is the only option here, and that is what I do. But the radar is definitely up. The turn is the king of hearts. It completes the rainbow, and he bets 25 again. Now, this is an interesting bet size because there's a chance he could be setting his own price, but I also think raising with a weak ace here is not the best play either. So I just decide to make the call again. The river is the queen of clubs, and he goes for that 3rd donk barrel. This time he sizes up to $100. So 100 into 146, this is a good chunk of a bet here. And after a donk into me on the flop and a barrel on a pretty dry board, I'm not really sure what we can be beating besides the weaker aces that are ace 5, ace 4, and ace 2. But I don't know if he'd be confident enough to bet those three streets. So because there's really no draws that miss either besides the wheel draw and 4-5, I don't really think we can make this call here. Let me know what you think. So I lay it down and he proudly flips over the good old-fashioned 2-6 offsuit. Says he wanted to make the vlog. Well, my man, you made the vlog. This day is just getting started for me. Buckle up.
What's up, guys? We look at a very pretty hand here. Pocket aces, two black ones to be exact. We're on the button and we see a raise from under the gun to $8. This is actually one of my best friends named Sasha. He's a very smart kid and doesn't go play poker all the time, but when he can, he definitely comes with us. And he knows what he's doing. All right, so he raises up to $8. Middle position makes the call, and I'm definitely going to raise it up. I decided to go for a sizing of $35. And to my surprise, Sasha re-raised me to $100. Middle position folds, and now I'm in a weird position. I think the best play here is just to stick it all in and literally just tell Sasha face up, I've got a nice strong hand. So that's what I do. I rip it all in for $350, $250 more. Sasha gives me a nice cold stare down and he makes the call. So pain coming for him as we go to a flop, which is inconsequential as he has pocket kings. I won't let him see the run out for that one, but he does not hit his king and we scoop home a big pot. Yeah, sorry about that one, Sasha. And of course, the first time I ever get aces versus kings in my life, it's against one of my best friends. Oh well, I'll take my 350 profit. Sorry, Sash.
Next hand for me was King Queen of Clubs in the small blind. There are two limps, and our good pal Prosper Donkey raises it up to 10, folds to me, and obviously I do like to 3-bet a good chunk of the time from the small blind. This is an instance where I'm just gonna make the call. I'm also feeling a little bit down on myself based on how the session has gone so far. But this is of course going to lead to the big blind calling and one more limper calling. So now we got to go four ways out of position, which isn't too fun. It is fun when you hit top pair. Queen 2-3 is the board with a spade draw. Checks to the Prosper Donkey, who c-bets for $25. I make the call and the limper calls as well. So we are down to three ways and the turn is the Jack of Hearts. Not a great card because we're now losing to Queen Jack. I still check, and it checks around. The river is the 4 of diamonds. I'm basically in check call mode, I would say. Let's get to showdown with our top pair here. I check, and this time the limper bets $75. Prosper Donkey, who I wish was the one betting into me on the river, folds, and now it is time to deliberate. We are now losing to Queen Jack, but we're ahead of a lot of weaker queens. The spade draw did miss as well. Straight draws didn't get there either. So I am going to make this call here most days of the week, today being one of them. I make the call, and he shows me the good old Queen 4 offsuit for the river 2 pair, ladies and gentlemen. It's just one of those days for me. It's funny to look back on now. In the moment, yeah, I'm pretty pissed off. He takes this one down, takes us to Value Town with the good old Queen 4. On to the next one, gentlemen.
For this hand, we look down at Queen 10 of Spades. Pretty solid hand, and the cutoff opens to $10. I decided to make the call on the button, and we see a call from the small blind and big blind as well. So we're off to a flop four ways, and the flop comes 10, King, Queen, 2 diamonds. Great flop from my hand, however, there are a lot of draws out there and other hands that definitely have some equity against us. It checks all the way to me. I decide to bet $20. Only the big blind makes a call, so we're off to a turn heads up, which is the 3 of clubs. Now there are two flush draws out there, and when he checks to me again, I want to size up here to charge these specific draws, so I decide to bet $55. The big blind thinks it over for a second before ultimately tossing in the call, and we're off to a river. Now the river is one of the worst cards in the deck for me, maybe not the worst because no diamond or club gets there, however it is the Jack of Spades. Any 9 or any ace gets there now with the straight, and if you happen to have the ace high flush draw, or even a flush draw with a 9 in his hand, he now has a better holding than me. The big blind thinks it over for a second and decides to lead out into me here for $125. This applies max pressure on me, puts me in a pretty tough spot. He's a pretty competent player who knows me and has seen the channel and knows that I'm capable of making tight folds like this with two pairs or sets. And he knows that that jack is often a pretty bad card for me, considering that my hand consists of mostly previously made hands on the flop. His sizing is a little weird to me, because if he really wanted me to call and he had the ace, I think he would have bet a little bit smaller into me. It seems like he's almost trying to push me out of the pot. So for those reasons, I ultimately make the call. And right when I make the call, he announces to me, good call. We take a nice one down. Glad we sniffed this one out and took home a nice pot.
Next, we look down at pocket tens on the cutoff. There is a limp. Prosper Donkey raises to 8, and there is a call. I raise it. I elect to 3-bet Prosper Donkey's wide range. I go for $30 as my sizing, and we get a call from the button, which prices in Prosper Donkey, which prices in the caller, Kara. So now we're going four ways to a flop. Please let it be good. 9-6-4 rainbow. Honestly, not too bad. Checks to me. I c-bet for $55 with our overpair. Folds to Kara, one of the dealers at the hideaway. She says that's not enough. Raises to $125. One of these days we'll catch a break, boys. One of these days. This is tough. I don't think we can make the fold just yet, given the strength of our hand, but Kara's a pretty straightforward player. I mean, I think her range is pretty value heavy on this board. Maybe she's got 7-8 or some sort of straight going for her at this point, but I'm not feeling too good as I make the call here. The turn is a rainbow 8. The board gets further connected, but
all in. Players all in.
She rips it all in, a little more than $200. I'm gonna put her on a lot of sets here. I don't really think we're ahead of much at this point. So there's even two pair combos that we can't beat. So I make the fold. She shows pocket nines, so we were way behind. This is just kind of the story of our night. Maybe we can fold flop. Let me know if we can fold flop, guys. I'm not too sure. Continuing to have fun here at the hideaway.
We've run pretty card dead for quite a while till I look down at 7-5 suited. Under the gun plus one. Under the gun straddles, and I decide just to limp here. I know it's a pretty fishy play to limp like that, but that's all right. Cutoff opens up to $15. It folds back around to under the gun, who makes a call. And for this price, I'm not going anywhere with the suited gapper. I make the call. We see a flop of ace, 8-6, 2 clubs, picking up an open-ended straight draw as well as a backdoor flush draw. Under the gun checks, and I decide to check as well, and the cutoff, the initial aggressor, bets $30. Under the gun folds, and I make the call, and we're off to a turn, which comes the 8 of hearts. I check once again, and the cutoff is pretty reluctant to check back. He leans back in his seat and picks up his phone, and now it seems like he's almost uninterested in the pot. I'm assuming he has a tight image on me, as I've been folding quite a bit and probably wouldn't be calling here without a strong holding. And so when the river comes the 10 of spades, although it doesn't connect with my hand, I don't assume the cutoff to have too much here. For those reasonings, I lead out for $60, hoping to steal this pot fairly quickly, which is actually the case. The cutoff folds, and we take down a nice little pot with a suited gapper like that. Let's go. After that, it's time to rack up, booking a nice little profit for the night.
In what is hopefully the last hand for me, we look down at pocket kings in the hijack. Under the gun plus one makes it 10. We see a call from middle position. I will be raising this up. I raise to $40, and the small blind is the only caller, interestingly enough. This is the same gentleman who flipped over queen four offsuit on me. So hopefully we can get some of those dollars back. Flop comes 4-6-9 with two clubs. He checks to me. I c-bet for $30, and he makes the call. The turn kind of blows. It's an ace, ace of hearts. He checks, and I am going to check back here. Maybe we need to not be scared and keep betting, charge those draws, but this obviously is not a fun card to see, so I do check back here. And the river, to make things more fun, is the jack of clubs, completing the flush draw. And to make things even more fun for me on my already super fun day, he leads out for $45 here. It's been a rough day, guys. It really has been a rough day at this point. I flip over the kings. This is not a really big bet. The pot's like 205 now that I'm looking over the notes, which is a pretty big pot. And this is a pretty small bet. But I really don't know what I'm beating. And last time this guy value bet the river, we paid him off. So I'm thinking hopefully I can make one correct play on the night and not let him squeak out any more value from me. Maybe the pot odds make it too good, but I lay down the Kiggities. He is nice enough to show me 3-4 of clubs for the flush. That's it for me, I hope. What's up, boys and girls? He's into the game for 680, out for 216. You do the math, but I'm pretty sure that's my worst loss ever. Just everything that could go wrong today went wrong. I'm sure when I look over the notes that there were some things I could have improved upon, but it really did feel like the cards and runouts were against me. Yeah, biggest loss ever. Just people showed up with the weirdest hands against me. People tried to bluff me for the vlog. It worked. I don't know. Just everything went wrong. We're going to hit the books. We'll be back better than ever. Glad that Frankie got a win for us. Hopefully Jello can get a win for us as well. But that's it for me. I have a final tomorrow. Sorry, Mom. Hopefully we can do well on that. I'll talk to you guys later. Peace.
What is up, guys? I am in Miami in my underwear, which I will not show you that, but I didn't record an outro for this video. I ended up taking Sasha out for some dinner, paid for from me, for that nice Aces versus Kings hand. So felt a little bad after that one, but you know how that goes. In for the game for 300, out for 885 for a profit of $585. Not a bad session, although some of that was my homies.
Wow, what's up, boys and girls? It is late out here. We just grinded back a 1-2 session. Was stuck about 250 at one point and grinded it back. Ended, cashed out with 605, in for 500. So made a little profit on the night, not too bad. Definitely took some time. Eventually we were able to grind it back, so glad to see that. We'll catch you in the next one. Don't forget to follow the Instagram and check out our merch at nextgenpokershop.com. All right, I'll catch you later. Peace.